pathogenesis of COVID-19. COVID-19 is a virus which spreads, as all of us know, possibly mainly through respiratory droplets. So this viral infection, like any other viral infection, presents asymptomatically or symptomatically. Asymptomatically, majority of the patients happens to be asymptomatic in this disease. You do not find any kind of symptoms in these patients. But those who are symptomatic will present with cough, fever, throat pain, difficulty in breathing. So these are the common clinical findings which you get, along with muscle ache or body ache. Recently, they have included loss of smell and loss of taste, also is one of the clinical findings. Also, along with this, patients also had presented with the diarrhea kind of symptoms, weakness kind of symptoms. So all these features, by one or the other way, like any other viral infection, has also given an idea that this could be a COVID virus infection. Well, how this virus gets transmitted? So there are a lot of myths regarding this and a lot of facts regarding this. So ideally, or in ideal situation, a COVID virus enters the body or exits the body through one of these three passages. Number one, mouth. Number two, nose. Number three, eyes. So we call it as the T-shaped area in the face. So any secretions in the mouth, any secretions in the throat, any secretions in the nose, or thick secretions from the eyes, all these are supposed to be infectious. So virus enters through this route, or it get exited through this route. Well, once the virus enters the body, it takes its presence in the respiratory secretions and it gets into the alveoli and causes all the pathogenetic features which this virus is going to cause. So pneumonitis, so infection happens, pneumonia-like features happens, and excess of secretions, secretions get clogged over there, desquamation will happen, and finally you will have respiratory difficulty. So this is how generally the pathogenesis moves as far as COVID is concerned. The secretions, the oral secretions, the throat secretions, the nasal secretions are the main areas where COVID virus, this coronavirus, can actually multiply. So when the person sneezes or when the person goes for a close contact with the other person, or when exactly the sneezing material comes out of the body, it is said because of its gravity or because of its size, the viral particles cannot travel more than 6 feet. So within 6 feet, if it comes in contact with the next person, it is going to get transmitted. There are a lot of myths regarding the transmission of the viruses, whether the viruses can be transmitted through the sweat, whether the viruses can be transmitted through tears, whether the viruses can be transmitted through the stool or any other body fluids. So basically the transmission is through the respiratory droplets, number one. Number two, there is one study in US which has shown that a patient has transmitted, or they have isolated the virus even in the fluids from the tears. So ideally tears is not a fluid where the transmission can happen, but however, in cases of associated conjunctivitis, etc., when there is a thick fluid, in fact that also can become a media for the growth of the viral particles. So for example, sweat, there is no evidence to say that sweat is one of the medias where viruses can be transmitted. Stool samples, fluids like stool, urine, we need to get we need to get a lot of materials, scientific materials, on whether viruses can be transmitted through these particles. But in general, it has been considered that stool also can show positive viral load, and even the urine also. But however, there are no scientific proof as of now to correctly establish whether there can be transmission through these fluids. If you consider other fluids like bronchoalveolar fluid, okay, one fluid, or ascitic fluid, or peritoneal fluid, cerebrospinal fluid, okay, though there are no current evidence to say that there is a transmission route from this, but however, we must consider that there is a possibility of an aerosol spread whenever we handle this either in the OTs or in the laboratories, because aerosol spread can happen from the fresh tissues. So when we handle fresh tissues in frozen sections during surgeries, or when we handle in the laboratory the fluids like ascitic fluid or pleural fluid or cerebrospinal fluid, we have to consider that it is infectious unless proved otherwise. So as doctors, probably we need to take care a little more, as we are in direct contact with the patients, direct contact with the body fluids of these patients, either in the clinical side or in the hospital or in the laboratory side. Okay. So transmission, though it is only predominantly aerosol and through the respective droplets, we must consider that we are prone for this transmission as medical personnel, and we have to take enough care regarding this. Well, another thing which I wanted to tell as far as COVID is concerned, how do we diagnose COVID virus infections? So as of now, we have different modalities for the diagnosis of COVID. One of the ways how in which we can diagnose COVID 19 infection is through doing a rapid testings. These rapid testings are not yet come to the complete clinical practice, because they are awaiting ICMR clearance. But however, this can show up IgM and IgG levels, which can be demonstrated by rapid point of care testing. So just like any HIV card or HPSAG card, it will have a control line, it will have an IgM line, it will have an IgG line. And test is done using the blood samples. And the moment the patient develops antibodies to the viral infections, he will show the positivity of these antibodies. But as far as antibody test is concerned, it doesn't show positivity, especially when you talk about IgM, in the first 7 days, and doesn't show positivity for IgG for the first 14 days. That means to say, even if the patient has got a suspicious COVID viral infection, he will not show positive testing. So this is what is the problem in the cases of the so-called rapid testing. So rapid testing, what happens here is in the first 7 days, patient will not show anything, though he is infected. So what to do for this? So we have other tests which are more confirmatory, which currently we take the special test, what are called as polymerase chain reaction, that is PCR testing. So PCR testing is obviously, it is the gold standard for COVID testing. And technically speaking, if the virus is present in an individual, we have to detect from the day one itself. How to take the samples for PCR? For the PCR testing, we take samples from that is swab samples from either the oropharynx or from the nasopharynx. Ideally, we have to take from both and transport this to the laboratory using viral transport media. We call it as VTM, viral transport media. Let me tell you how the samples has to be collected for COVID-19 testing. So all of us know, PCR testing is a gold standard, and it is the ideal test methodology in which diagnosis of COVID-19 is done in today's laboratory practice. Well, as health professionals, we have to take an utmost care while collecting the samples. Number one, possibly because we may get infected. Number two, possibly we may get a sample which is false negative. So an ideal sampling should be done with a person who has been trained on this, and this should be done by keeping a correct distance from the patients. How to establish a distance as well as how to collect a good sample? This can be done using coils, in which patient is in the outside the box and the collecting the health personnel is within the box, and only the hand will go outside the box with the gloves to the patient to approach for patient's swab samples. Well, for PCRs, respiratory samples is an ideal sample to take. So we can take nasopharyngeal samples, we can take oropharyngeal samples, and also we can take bronchoalveolar lavage samples. Bulk fluid should be taken in an OT setup or an endoscopy setup. In an OPD setup, what we can take is a sample from oropharynx or sample from nasopharynx. Ideally, it is better to take samples from both at one settings. So we can introduce this swab to the area of the oropharynx, and as well as we can introduce another swab at the area of the nasopharynx, and correctly the samples are taken from there, the secretions are taken from there, and it is kept in a viral transport media for the transporter. So this transport of the samples should also be done in a controlled temperature controlled atmosphere in a proper container, and this should be transported to the laboratory as early as possible. So I was talking about the PCR testing in case of COVID-19. PCR is a gold standard for testing COVID viruses, and technically speaking, PCR should be positive from the day one the person is infected. But however, we can get false negative reports in PCR if the sampling is not proper. So it's very important that sampling is done by a professional trained technologist, and this sample or a throat swab has to be collected from exactly the oropharyngeal areas or the nasopharyngeal areas. Preferably both areas we collect. And it is said from the nasopharynx the viral extraction is much better, and it is the most ideal place where we are supposed to collect the samples for COVID test. Now once the sample collection is done, it is transported in a viral transport media and properly packed with the temperature controlled boxes, and it has to be transported to the lab. So as all of us know, PCR is a polymerase chain, it is a real-time reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. After all, it finds the type of RNA by using specific primers. So we use specific primers for the identification of COVID viruses, and by doing polymerase chain reaction, we are exactly identifying the nucleotide sequence the patient is having, and that nucleotide sequence, if it matches with the primer what we are using, then we make a diagnosis of COVID viral infections. Well, there can be situations where there are false negative cases even in PCRs. It has to be prevented from very good sampling techniques as well as testing techniques. Equipmentation for PCR are there, wherein automatically we do the viral extractions and also the RNA viral extractions and amplifications, and identification of this viral genome can be done. Well, nowadays we have other technologies also where antibodies can be detected in the human blood by using technologies like electrochemiluminescence. This is a technology wherein the antibodies IgM and IgG are quantitatively or qualitatively detected by using specialized equipmentations for chemiluminescence. And obviously, if the patient has developed antibodies, you can detect the IgM antibodies early and IgG antibodies later on in the infectious period. But however, if both has to be present in a patient who is infected with COVID, generally it should be at least 14 days of infection. So if you want to detect COVID virus infection at an early stage, possibly antibody detection is not a recommended technology. However, you can use most recommended technology, that is polymerase chain reaction. I just wanted to add a note on what are the precautions as health professionals we have to take when we deal with suspected COVID patients. I want to say that universal precaution is a must for everybody as far as health professionals are concerned. We have to consider every patient possibly as an infective COVID virus patient. Unless proven otherwise, you are a laboratory personnel or you are a clinician or you are a health personnel. In this era, possibly in this season, probably we have to consider each and every sample and each and every patient may be possibly infectious COVID patients unless proven otherwise, because we don't know whether we are dealing with an asymptomatic patients or symptomatic patients. Establishment of fever clinics and as per the guidance of the ICMR, how the patient has to move through a fever clinic before he reaches a doctor, and what are the precautions what we have to take. So of course, screening of these patients with his history taking, with his travel history or with the clinical signs and symptoms, we come to a conclusion that this patient may be a suspicious COVID patient. So in such cases, or in all cases in today's scenario, it is very important that we take universal precautions. Of course, N95 mask is a must now. And we use face masks where we keep the distance with the patients. Our face gets the distance with the patients so that we don't have a direct contact. And of course, the cap and the mask along with the body gown possibly will help us as a personal protective equipments, will definitely help us in avoiding any infections which are possibly coming to a health professional. There is nothing to worry, rather we have to be cautious. When we are handling these patients, especially when there is a suspected COVID patient, when you are taking a sample for a COVID from a COVID patient, we have to ensure that universal precautions are taken. And if you are taking a sample for PCR in a hospital setup or in a clinic setup, there should be a proper kiosk wherein there is a proper distance that has been maintained from patient and the health person. Doctors, like any other, it is better to keep 6 feet distance with the patients. And examination, if you need to go close to the patients, should be done with all the universal precautions on. Okay, so you need to have the gloves in your hand properly, with your face mask, with your cap and mask, and with your PPE. Better to handle these patients in such a situation, and also ensuring that there is PPE that has been used judiciously. Looking at the cost of the PPE also, in which we are using for each and every patient. Regarding the laboratory personnel, when you are handling COVID patient samples, you also consider that this patient is every sample, in other words, every sample should be treated as infectious and positive for COVID unless proved otherwise. Because what I'm telling you, why I'm telling this is because we use this for all any patient. If it's an HIV patient also, or if it is any sample which is arriving at laboratory, we consider that this is infectious and we act accordingly. So in the same way, you need to do it for COVID patients also. So no need to become panicky about this. Rather, let us be cautious in handling these patients or suspected. Probably
COVID is likely to be there for many number of months, many more years. Possibly we as health professionals should, like general public, we also should try to live with COVID and live with the practice of COVID in the days to come. Thank you.